how we should be leading our lives going forward. So what can we do? The most paramount thing is to take care of our health, our near and dear ones, our colleagues, remain well, stay healthy, do a lot of changes in our lifestyle, in our daily routines. Be mindful of what we are doing, what we are eating, how we are behaving, you know, what are the kind of habits we've inculcated. These are very, very important in today's times and going forward that we'll need to be mindful of. And in this webinar, over the next 45 minutes or so, we will introduce one or two new dimensions of health and wellness, which you may or may not be aware, but I'm sure and I can promise you that the next 45 to 50 minutes will be worth your time and you'll gain a lot of information out of this. So before we jump onto the session, just a brief introduction about myself and Manisha. We both are directors of Synergy Environics Limited. We started this company in the year 2007. The company is into various health and wellness initiatives. A little bit of them we'll cover in the later part of the talk. And at a personal level, both of us are very, very keen enthusiasts on various subjects related to health and wellness. We read a lot. We try to learn a lot of new practices, techniques, some which we implement in our life, some we discard, or some we know we have to do it, but that's life. You keep doing, you learn something, you start something, you like something, and then you propagate it. So that's a little bit about us. We're not going to bore you with too much of introduction. So Manisha, let's get into it and let's start this.
Yes, that's perfect. So let's start the...
So if you can start the slide share and slides, we can go over to the next one. Okay, so, you know, just, and again, all of you are aware of this. This is just to set the context of the webinar today. In the last few days, where we've all been in the lockdown mode, in the second wave of coronavirus, we all went through this last year as well. And by the reports which we are hearing, there are going to be frequent lockdowns in the future as well.
Yeah.
Hopefully this gets over sometime soon, but that's going to be the way of life. So we are all leading a highly sedentary lifestyle, not as active as what we all used to be. You know, even if we were in the workplace or in the office, we used to move around in the office talking to people. Today we are holed up in a chair on these virtual calls, video meetings, con calls, and we maybe not moving as much. All of us know that, you know, from morning to evening, or some people at night, we are all always on a virtual way of working, on the Zoom calls, Google Meet calls, phone calls. Again, that's not very normal. In an office situation, you would have a physical interaction away from your screens. So your screen time has increased exponentially. In addition to, of course, once you finish your work, a lot of these entertainment platforms, OTT, you know, great content out there, I must say. You know, I've personally got hooked on to many, many of these Netflixes and Amazon last year. So great content. So yes, it's something that you are hooked onto the screen for a longer part of the day, unfortunately. Our children. So, you know, just to tell you about myself, I have a 3-year-old and he doesn't know what school is. I mean, he's in pre-nursery and he started his school journey with looking at a screen, seeing about 15, 20 other children on the screen and a couple of teachers, you know, reading stories and what how pre-nursery is. Now, between me and my wife, we keep discussing that when we have to transition him to proper school, say next year, you know, he'll be like, what are you doing? Why are you sending me somewhere? I understand school as being somewhere in front of the screen. Why are you sending me away from home? So there's going to be a huge social development issue which might come up in children, which could be due to this. And again, as a family, our entire exposure has gone up exponentially. That's quite obvious. So this is just a visual that we thought we put up, that all of this, and you might be feeling it, you may not know the cause of this, but by the end of the day, in these times when we are working from home, although we are home, we are not commuting to work, you know, so that part of the stress is over, but probably we all are feeling more fatigued by the evening or by late night. And again, so we are going to be talking about one of the major causes of this fatigue and higher stress over the course of this webinar and giving you some kind of simple solutions which you can adopt in your daily lifestyle. Again, the idea is that you should pass this on to your team members and to your colleagues so that they can implement these things. So again, before we continue, just thought we'll take a quick poll on, you know, what is your screen time during the day? So Manisha, if you can help with running the poll.
Yes.
You shall see it in the screen. So I'll read out the question for all of you. How many hours do you spend on your mobile phone, laptop, tabs, smart TVs, and any other personal electronic device that you have with you at your home? So how many hours do you spend in a single day, cumulatively?
It's great to see the numbers. I'm just going to show the numbers shortly, just for another 1 second. We will have the poll on another few seconds, and then I will close the poll and we will show the numbers.
So Manisha, what I'm seeing is as expected. I mean, there's no...
That's true.
Obvious, and, but I think the idea was for all of you to realize that, you know, this is something which doesn't happen in a regular day. You're not so much on the screen. You have multiple breaks during the day. Great.
So here, I have shared the result.
So 91% of the people are on some form of the screen or the other for more than 4 hours a day. Now, it's very interesting when we were formulating this poll, we could have kept this as 6 hours or 8 hours, or let's put it at four hours. Because this is what world over, you know, any device manufacturer also recommends, that you should not be on a device for that much time. But again, the idea was to just to capture and make you realize that for majority of your day, you know, you're on the screen, some form of the screen or the other. So thank you, Manisha. We can stop the poll.
So interesting thing is we just asked the question 4 hours, but a recent poll, which was done by Independent UK, they found that 34 years of our average adult life is going to be spent in front of screen. And that is something which is very important, because we are spending almost 90% of our waking hours with the screen time. And most of the studies showed that half the people felt that it was for non-productive work, which we all know, like Pranav was talking about. But the interesting fact also is that 64% admitted that if I don't do the screen time, what else will I do in this time? I don't know. So we are very, very thankful for this digital world and technology, that it is connecting us to the world at large. And worst is that 40% people actually were worried about not for themselves just, but for their children. And they didn't know how to tell them, because they were culprit themselves of spending as much time on the screen. So this is what brought us to this topic, is that how can we talk about this whole thing? How is it impacting our health? And the key trigger is what we or the researchers are calling this whole phenomena as electrosmog. Smog, we all know, especially the Delhiite and the Gurgaon fraternity, we all know what air smog is. But the kind of smog we are surrounding ourselves with technology, and the invisible aspect of the radiation around the technology, is something which we need to worry about. And this visual is just giving you an idea, technology, where all it is coming from, starting from your toddler having that, when I was talking about that, now on the screen time and being baby monitors right from the day of the birth, and all of us using this kind internally as well as sometimes externally through your Wi-Fi router or through your mobile tower or high tension wireline. And some of you would be knowing, but I just wanted, when I started research on this fact, I didn't know that WHO had put this whole mobile radiation into a category which is 2B category, which is probable cancerous. In the same category, we have exhaust fumes, lead and asbestos. So I don't have to say much on that further. And BBC News came out with this recently, that what kind of impact it can have. And most of the impact it is talking about is our day-to-day stress factors. So headache, you many times you would not associate with this at all. Or the loss of immunity. We do many other things to take care of headaches. Next time, please remember your screen time is one of them. And I don't know how many of you have read phone manual, but you can maybe put it in the chat box if some of you have read phone manual. I would love to hear that, and maybe Pranav will take you further and what is written in the phone manual.
So yeah, that's how right? We buy a new mobile phone. We all play around it with 15 minutes and we figure out how to use the phone. So unfortunately, nobody reads the phone manuals. Earlier, you know, with the earlier phones, there used to be a paper booklet which used to come. Now, no longer. I mean, the entire manual is inbuilt into the phone. So they've made it even tougher for you to read the manual. And you really have to, again, figure out where that manual is. But again, just to tell you that every cell phone manufacturer, irrespective of the brand, whether it's a multinational company or an Indian homegrown company, has something called as a warning against RF exposure. Now, RF exposure is radio frequency exposure. And to a layman, that is purely just radiation. You know, they don't write warning against radiation because obviously their legal teams tell them not to write, use the word radiation. So every brand in every phone handset has a section called warnings against RF exposure. You can easily find it in your phone. And practically what they say is these four warnings in every brand. Some might give three warnings, but usually you would find these four warnings. Number one, your recommended talk time should not exceed 6 minutes in an hour. Whenever you're talking, always use a wired earphone, not a Bluetooth. Bluetooth is equally bad. Third, text more than you talk. Talk only if absolutely necessary. And the fourth, always keep the device 5 millimeters, 10 millimeters, 15 millimeters away from your body at any given point of time.
And your hand is your body.
Yeah, hand is your body. Your ear is your body. For men, the pocket is also part of the body. Women have an advantage. They can keep it in their handbags. So these four things, again, if we're not taking a poll because we know the answer, there is not a single individual on this planet who can really implement all these four things simultaneously. Yes, I know a lot of people who talk only using the earphone, but they may not be doing the other three things. So you really, you know, you need to be aware that what this is something that the cell phone manufacturer is telling you. Similarly, on the laptop, if you read a laptop manual, which again, I know that nobody reads, a laptop says that never keep it on your lap. So that's a kind of a misnomer that the name of the device is a laptop, but the manufacturer says never keep it on your lap.
In fact, there is a law around this in US that the manufacturer have to write and in the packaging that you have a right of knowledge. So they are supposed to write these four things right on the packaging. And many other laws around the world, which you can see are here, have woken up to this fact.
So a lot of developed countries have taken a lot of initiative in this, in making people aware of the harmful on their health. What is the harm on their health due to extra exposure, due to Wi-Fi and all these radiations. So we're not going to read through it, but you can find this on the internet. So why are we talking about this? Because obviously your employees need protection. Because of the current scenario where they are continuously on their phones and laptops and Wi-Fi routers in their bedrooms or on the desk that they're working on, your employees need to be protected. And maybe Manisha, you can tell everybody more about what are the short-term and long-term effects.
I think so. It's pretty obvious. Sleep disorder is one of them. And I have experienced this myself before I knew about this whole arena of technology and its impact. Lack of focus, which most of us feel, and long-term effect, many of us know about increased risk of tumor. There is enough data and research world over which talks about all this. But the key again is that there is no problem in short-term exposure. Problem is because the amount we are using, which we talked about in the beginning. So that's where we have to be a little careful. And there is another factor which is talked about. There is a phenomena called EHS, electrohypersensitivity. This is something which, there is some goof up happening with the, I think so. Sorry about this goof up, but if you can just give me 2 minutes and you can carry on, I'll just get that.
So electromagnetic hypersensitivity is a disease which not many people know about. But doctors are waking up to this disease now. And in Sweden, because Sweden, if you know, was the first country to adopt mobile phone technology. Nokia as a company belongs to Sweden. So they were the first people or citizens who started using mobile phone technology in the late 80s and early 90s. And today it is well documented that about almost 5% of entire Sweden's population is suffering from electromagnetic hypersensitivity. So this is a terminology which is very, very new. And in the future, you will hear more about it. Now, it's a disease where your hands start shaking. You're not being able to focus. Your attention span becomes lower. All these things are signs of electromagnetic hypersensitivity. And just to give you a statistic, in the year 2001, there was one person for every 100,000 people who were suffering from EHS. In the year 2015, there was one person who was suffering from it for every 1,000 people. So this whole problem has increased 100 times between 2001 and 2015. We don't have published numbers post 2015, but I'm pretty sure it would be much more alarming now. So that's the kind of a thing which happens with multiple exposure to multiple gadgets all around you. And as we showed you in one of the earlier slides, that your home or your desk is like a radiation war zone. You are surrounded in terms of when we're having these virtual meetings, we need to have the best possible connection, the fastest broadband, the fastest speed. And hence the kind of networking equipment that we install at our homes is of, you know, extremely, extremely high radiation signals. So hence we need to be protected against all these radiations which are emitting from all these devices, like routers and all of these things. I think Manisha is having some difficulty in pulling up the slide, so I'll continue to talk. But we also wanted to share a slide, which if Manisha is able to pull up, that really radiation protection is a game of distance. And it is purely a matter of how far you are away from a radiation emitting source. So for example, a mobile phone. If you are about 1.5 feet away from a mobile phone, then you're safe. But obviously the nature of the device is such that you always keep it with you. But the point is thank you, Manisha, for showing this. So for a mobile phone, it's about 1.5 feet. A laptop is 3 feet. And then again, you have your mobile towers. A lot of people might be concerned about mobile tower radiation. So if you're about 30 to 50 meters, which is about 100 to 150 feet away from a mobile tower, then the radiation from that mobile tower is not harming you. However, on the flip side, if you're within that range, then it is doing some harm to you. Same with a Wi-Fi router, depending on the router and the strength, about 7 to 10 feet is the distance where you should be keeping it away. And similarly, many other devices. In an office, if you have server rooms, so ideally people should be sitting about 15 to 16 feet away from a server room. But the point is, all these things may not be practically possible every time. And hence, we'll be talking more about the solutions that you can adopt for taking care of these radiations. So Manisha, if I have missed out, I think we were to take some tips on that. So, you know, the way we are leading our lives all hold up inside our homes. And I think this is going to continue for a while. And if a third wave comes in, then again, we'll be locked up inside our homes in the next few months. So what we're trying to say is that be aware of what the device manufacturers are telling you. And what we've told you. So be more mindful of it. Share this knowledge with your near and dear ones that you should not be talking for more than 6 minutes in an hour and all of that. If you're giving your device to your children for watching a video, do download that video and then give it to them. Don't have it on Wi-Fi mode or 4G or 3G networks.
Yeah, I just want to add here, the WHO has put in the 2B category. In the same category, cigarette used to be there 40 years back.
Yeah.
So if any of you are happy giving cigarettes to your kids, it's equivalent that you are giving your mobile or laptop to play with. So please be careful on that front.
Other few tips, which some of you may know, but again, we wanted to reiterate that. Sometimes we don't forget about this. Very, very important to stay hydrated. Because water is a major source of, you know, keeping your mind fresh, body fresh, your productivity high, your health in a good shape. So again, a tip that whenever you're starting a meeting on a virtual platform, pour a glass of water before you start that meeting and ensure that that glass of water is over by the end of that hour. So really drink a glass of water every hour. That's going to really help you in terms of, you know, being fresh. Always take short breaks. Sometimes we have back-to-back meetings from morning to the afternoon. We just take a short lunch break and then we're back in front of the screen. It'll really help you to schedule time and have just a 15-minute break for some recreation. Listen to some music, read a few pages of a book. If you have children at home, you know, spend some time with them. Take short breaks. Again, this works wonders in refreshing your mind and body. And, you know, you can carry on through well till the late evening with your work.
And please, digital break also.
Absolutely. During your meal times, you know, my wife keeps telling me that you instantly, if a message comes and it says ting, I instantly look at it. So I've made it a habit that while in during the meal times, I'm going to keep the phone at least about 6 feet away so that I can't reach out to it. And before sleeping, that's again something that I practice, that at least 20 to 25 minutes before I go to bed, I don't even look at my phone. If I have to set an alarm, that's another topic, but if I have to set an alarm, I set it well before and then I don't look at the mobile phone screen before sleeping. So what we wanted to do in this webinar and for all of you who are attending for this is, we wanted to share a digital handbook with all of you. And through you, we wanted you to share it with, ideally with all your colleagues and your teams and your employees, so that they can also learn more about these things and get to know what are the simple ways in which they can stay protected. So we wanted to take a quick poll on that who all would like to receive it. And we also wanted to offer you that for your teams and employees in your organization, we could curate maybe a 60-minute or a 90-minute virtual workshop just to raise awareness on this subject, that why they need to stay healthy, stay protected from all these different kind of sources of radiation and other things, and what are the ways in which they can stay protected. In this webinar, of course, we have shortage of time, so we've just covered snippets of it. But in a longer workshop, we can actually give them many more tips. So one is, would you like to give a copy of this digital handbook? And the second question is, would you be interested in organizing an awareness and wellness workshop for all your employees?
So we are getting a lot of responses. This is something which I will not share because that's not of interest, but I'll just wait for a couple of more seconds and then we'll move on to our...
So I think we can give it another 5 seconds, Manisha.
Yes. Thank you everyone for polling for this. And I can see a lot of interest and we will connect with you for this particular, whatever interest you have shown. I'm ending the poll and we can start off with the next.
Thank you, Manisha.
So Pranav talked a little bit about environics, but what environics is all about, as the name suggests, it takes care of your environment and its impact on your well-being. So our vision is actually to make every individual and their working and living spaces healthier, safer, and more productive. And when I talk about spaces, a large portion of that is digital and gadget specific. And there are other aspects of spaces also environics looks at, which are natural radiation. Maybe we can talk about it sometime later in some other webinar. Just to give you brief, we are lucky that so many of the organization have taken that care responsibility for their employees, and we have worked with them to make their workspaces, make their manufacturing unit, as well as their other spaces healthier and protected for themselves, for their employees, and for their clients. So our MD has given us a very huge mission to touch people's lives, 100 million people's lives in next 3 years. And we are there. We have touched till now 6 million lives. But with your help and with your organization's help, we want to reach to those many people and ensure that they are well protected. So So these are some of the things which we have done, as I was talking to you about. We have worked in more than 480 offices and many other manufacturing units and plants. So Pranav, would you like to take them through wellness solutions?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think we couldn't show that slide earlier, but before I get into this, So there was a study done by Harvard a couple of years back in the US, where they did a survey in 22 organizations and on their employees and now what on their HR practices. And what they published a report on was that every $1 spent on health and wellness initiatives by the organization resulted a savings in $3.27, which could have been lost due to absenteeism of the employees due to having health issues. So this was a great report. It's a very detailed report which has been published by Harvard Medical. And so that's an eye-opener that, you know, really it's the need of the hour. It's no longer a choice. It's a necessity, especially in these times, that as business leaders and HR professionals, we must implement certain wellness measures in the organization to take care of our employees. So just to talk about, we talked about simple DIY tips, do-it-yourself tips. But sometimes you need extra protection and extra safety. I mean, all those things are absolutely fine and you should do that. But what over and above that? You know, a lot of people ask us that, okay, we did this, but can we get something on our devices? Can we fix something on our devices which will take care of these radiations completely?
In fact, Pranav, in the chat, many people have written that they are not able to have that safe distance. And they are not able to follow most of the things which people are talking about. So that's where I think so you, apart from habit changes, which will come slowly in our lives, we need certain protection. We protect our phone by putting cover on the phone, but it is important to have the safety gadget on the phone or for on your various gadgets so that you protect yourself.
It's like the car, right? You have a vehicle, you have a safety belt in the car. Now, why do you wear that? Just to add a layer of safety while you're moving in a car. So this is that additional layer of safety for your gadgets, mobile phones, laptops, Wi-Fi routers, smart TVs. And this is a brand which is developed by us. It's patented by us. It's manufactured by us. You just stick it onto your device on the back of your phone and on your laptop and other devices. And it completely neutralizes the harmful effect of electromagnetic radiation from that device. And medically, we've tested this. It reduces your stress levels significantly. And again, Max Healthcare, Ames, all these people have done a lot of research on this. And I won't get into the details of this. If you are interested in knowing more, our team will connect with you. This is another device called EnviroGlobe. Again, this is an invention which we had about 3 years back. It's an electrosmog purifier. Like you have a water purifier, you have an air purifier. This is an electromagnetic radiation purifier. You just keep it in your room. So while I'm on this virtual call, I have it on my desk as well. And you can carry it with you. So if you're traveling, not right now, but when things will normalize, you will travel. So it's like a travel companion. You can keep it in your bag. If you're staying in a hotel room, you take it out and you keep it. Keep it in your living room, keep it in your cabin, in your desk, in your bedroom. It just purifies whatever are the external sources of radiation which might be impacting you. This will purify all that radiation for you. So again, it works within an area of 300 square feet and again, reduces your stress levels, which can be medically proven.
So these are some of the tests and results Tana was talking about. In fact, we are proud to say that recently we conducted and finished that test with positive results with All India Medical Research Center, which is very rare that a private company is associated with their clinical trials, but we did it on EEG of the brain, the impact of these mobile radiation on the EEG of the brain and how EnviroChip can take care of that. So this research is under publication right now. Apart from that, you can go through various other tests and research which we have done. Now, actually, electrosmog is part of the green building initiative. It's part of WELL standard of green building because they feel that it is very, very critical for the wellness of the people within the building. So So these are the things which, apart from taking care of the employees, many, many organizations are using it as also as a part of branding. And it's a very nice way of branding because the back of your mobile is seen by at least 300 to 400 people every year. And it creates conversation. It creates a way to say that, yes, it's a WeCare gift because nobody will put that gift away. Most of the time, if you get certain gift, you say, theek hai, next time hum usko gift kar denge, dusro ko ye gift. But this is something which everybody uses it. And in last organization, like you have seen, we have worked a lot with them, like Bank of Baroda gave it to all their stakeholders because they felt that this is something which will help them remember Bank of Baroda and various other companies. So we have curated certain home essential pack for you, and we can curate more for you because depending on what you want to give it to your employees, what you want to use it for yourself. And this is, I would say, why I call it essential pack. We have already talked about it, that it's no more a choice. Safety is essential. Sorry. So I'll just go for one more quick poll. Just if any of you would like to be interested in this, if you can let us know, then our team will connect with you. So just at the end of the webinar, then we'll open up for question answer. Just give us what if you found the session useful, and please let us know because that will help us also curate a much better interaction in future. And this will just take a couple of seconds for you. So please vote on this. And then we will open up for Q&A. I see many question answer here, but more of you can write your questions here. And I see interesting chat also.
Yes, we can take a lot of questions. The idea was to keep the session a little brief and short so that we can answer more questions for you live as we go along with this.
So your true feedback will be really, really appreciated. And you can even message us, write to us. Just a couple of more seconds. And then whoever wants any questions to be answered, please put it in a Q&A. And we will open up for Q&A shortly. So I am ending the poll.
This work from home is very different from the previous lockdown work from home. I think this time, generally, everybody knew what to expect, how to go along with it. And hence, our exposure to all these devices is much more in this lockdown. The previous, I think people took a couple of weeks just to figure out what to do. And hence, they had a lot of time available for their recreational needs as well. I think this time, when we talk to a lot of business leaders, the answer that they give us is, just from morning to night, they're just swamped with work. There is probably more work happening now versus what used to happen earlier. But the downside is that they are always on their laptop.
Thank you so much. I just thought I'll share because 100% people have said they liked it and it makes me feel really, really proud.
This is happy, yes.
And happy. And also our team, I will just introduce our team who has worked really hard on this particular session. Prerna, Verma, Sanjeev, and the team behind the thing, Prerna. We have two Prerna's who work with us. So thank you so much, team. And we will open for question answer now. So I'm just stop the share.
So if team, if you can read out some of the questions and then we can answer it live.
Sure, sir. So before we move to Q&A, I would like to thank you and Manisha ji for such a wonderful and informative session. And I'm sure all the attendees who have been part of this session would have surely enjoyed the same. I'll start taking questions. I'll try to club the same, which are same. The first question is from Vasundha Pant. She says, hi Pranav, when we are talking about radiation from electronic devices and their ill effects on our health, are we also including smart bands? Should one avoid their usage as well?
It's a great question, Vasundha ji. Absolutely. Smart bands is actually, if you talk about it, it's probably the worst device because it's with you 24/7. We call mobile a phone as a device which is with us 24/7, but at least at night, I'm assuming that you would be keeping it 1.5 to 2 feet away from your head. But smart band, a lot of people, wear it while sleeping as well, because a lot of smart bands give you data on sleep quality and all of that. My advice to you is that try and limit the usage of smart bands to whatever was the objective that you had of wearing it. A lot of people have the objective of tracking their fitness goals, number of steps and all of that. Definitely use it for that, but maybe do not have it on you for 24/7. So use it for the objective it's meant for, but for keep seeing your time or whatever, just use a normal watch. That's my advice to you.
Okay. So I'll just take a similar question, which has just popped up. This is from Prerna Srivastava. She says, if we put a, if you use a smart wrist watch, and if you put a globe near the same, would it help protect the same?
No, it would not, because your smart band is actually in touch with your body. Your globe is like a purifier, so it will take care of external sources of radiation which are beyond your this thing, maybe a mobile tower in your neighbor's house or maybe a wire nearby. But something which is on you, which is touching your body, you need to put an EnviroChip on it. Unfortunately, we don't have a product for smart bands, but yes, for mobile phones and laptops, the EnviroChip is there. So smart bands, you need to figure out what you will do with it, because really it's not something which is very, very good for uses 24/7. So you need to limit the time that you have a smartwatch on you.
Okay, thank you. So the next question is from Ms. Sani. She says, if I want a wellness kit, what is the way forward?
So I think you can note down her details, Sanjeev. I think we'll have her details and we should connect with her. So we'll connect with you, ma'am.
Okay, sure, sir. Next question is from Mr.
There are multiple ways in which we can do that, and our team will share more details with you offline.
Sure, sir. So the next question is from Mr. Sajwan. He says, is TV set-top box of radiation are as harmful as mobile phone and mobile tower?
If you remember, we had shown a slide that radiation is a game of distance. Yes, there are electromagnetic waves from a set-top box, but I would assume that it's at least 6 to 8 feet away from you. So to that respect, I don't think that would really harm you too much. And maybe I don't think you would be watching TV for many, many hours at a stretch. So it's really a game of distance. If you have it.
But if you are playing games on TV and being very close to that, then yes, you need to then use protection. You need to.
That's when EnviroChip and EnviroGlobe can help in that.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you. So the next question is from Mr. Ravi. He says, does using Bluetooth technology reduce the possible health risk?
Bluetooth actually increases it because when you suppose you're having a Bluetooth earphone or headset, it's continuously transmitting those waves with your mobile device. Or if you have a Bluetooth speaker, it's continuously emitting and receiving waves from your electronic devices. So again, even the cell phone manufacturers don't recommend a Bluetooth device. But yes, it's definitely convenient to use. I mean, if you're jogging or walking and you are listening to an audiobook or music, it's convenient versus those wired earphones. But from a health perspective, it's not so good. So you really need to balance it out and see how much you're using it in your daily life. If it's moderate, maybe 15 minutes or max half an hour in a day, that's fine. But if you're using it for 3 hours or 6 hours in a day, then you need to watch out.
So very interesting question I'm seeing in the chat box is, should I off my internet during sleep time? Yes, Vidyaji has asked. And Vidyaji, yes, as Pranav was saying, that if your internet or the router is 10 and a half feet away from your bed position, then you don't need to switch it off. But yes, many a times we see our clients putting their router right next to their head, saying that this is how I will get the good, or right next to their workstation. Then you must switch it off before you sleep.
So Ms. Vidya has also put in the chat box that she has
just
told
to, just to add a point, Sanjeev, mobile tower. Sorry, carry on.
Yes, sir, please. What
I was saying was that, it's good to switch it off, because when you're sleeping, why do you need to look at your WhatsApp messages? You're sleeping, what Wi-Fi will help you is just to get your WhatsApp messages or all those things. So it's better to have a good quality of sleep and not be worried about the quality of signal which is coming on your phone.
That brings me to the topic which we were talking about. Normally, many of us put alarm on our smartphone. Many a times when we talk to people, they say we need our phone next to us because we are putting alarm on the phone. So my request would be, please buy a normal alarm clock. Not for that reason, put your phone next to your head and 1.5 feet distance. If you can still keep it, that would be wonderful.
Another tip on that is, even if you are putting the alarm on your mobile phone, switch off your mobile data. Because again, you don't need mobile data while you're sleeping. So your alarm will still ring if your mobile data is switched off.
Yeah, so that's true.
In that case, is just switch off your mobile data on your phone. Why do you need that 4G connection at night? You don't need that. A phone will still ring. SMS will still come. Alarm will still ring, even if you have the 4G and the mobile data. So that's another tip that I think would be useful for everybody.
And some people have raised their hand. If you can just put it in the chat box, or if I allow everybody to talk, then this can become a little more chaotic. But if you want, Mr. Suresh Patil had raised their hand. So should I allow him to talk, or would you put it in the chat box, Mr. Patil?
Till that time, Sanjeev, I think you were reading out another question. You can continue with that Q&A.
No, I was just adding on to what Vidyaji has asked. So if she even switches off her internet, which is at home, but she has mentioned in the chat box, she has a mobile tower, Idea Tower, which is almost 50 meters away from her home. So I think switching off the router would not help her.
Yes, Vidyaji, then you need solution.
So Ms. Deepika has a question, which is, I think, related to more of the set-top box. She says, what about PS4, PlayStation? Are they also harmful?
So, yeah, I think these games which kids nowadays play, where it's all, through artificial, a lot of artificial intelligence is built into it. A lot of virtual reality is built into it. You can play tennis with just that. There's a game called Wii, a platform called Wii, not only PS4, but more evolved game stations than PS4. Anything which is receiving an electronic signal and transmitting it back, if you are exposed to that signal for an extended period of time, then you need protection for it. Again, if you're using it only for a matter of 15 minutes or max half an hour in a day, it's still okay. Your body has your immune system has the ability to fight that much. But if you have it on for extended period of hours and hours, or if your children have it on for hours, then you need to again... See, one level is you can adopt any level of protection with EnviroChip. The best is to actually figure out a way with your children to limit the time that they use it. Maybe allow it for half an hour a day max. So that level of dialogue you need to have with your children that, it's fine to play games for a while, but not to exceed a time duration, maybe 15 minutes or half an hour at the most. That would be the best. If you can't do great, that, sir. Then yes, there are solutions available, as we mentioned.
Great, sir. Thank you. So the next question is from Mr. Shah. He says, what is the solution?
Mr. Shah, we talked about the solution and we can send you more details. But solution is that there is a change in your habits. Adopting simple techniques, which we talked about, can take care of many of the concerns which we are speaking about. And second is, do use protection. It's another safety layer which you need to use it for. You do it for everything in your life. This is also an important part of your safety and well-being. So use, I would say, product and solutions which can help you take care of this problem.
Sure. So just to end, before I would like to take the last question. The question is from Sarma, Ms. Sarma. She says, this is a concern lots of people are facing. She says, when 5G comes, is it good or it's the same thing? How harmful is basically the 5G?
I think we were silently waiting for a question like this, because last 2 days, there's been a lot of hot debate on this. For some of you, if you don't know, Juhi Chawla, who's the Bollywood celebrities, has filed a PIL in Delhi High Court against 5G technology. So there's a lot of debate and social media discussion on it. So see, 5G is going to get introduced. 2G came, then 3G, 4G, 5G. 2 years later, we'll be talking about 6G. So this is something which is going to keep coming on every 2 to 3 years. The point is that any electromagnetic radiation is harmful, whether it's 4G or 5G. And there are solutions like ours which are available. Obviously, we have not tested our solution exactly on 5G, but the technology that we use will definitely take care of the harmful effects of 5G on your human health. But again, having said that, one would need to wait for more data to come in. One would need to see what kind of equipment the telecom operators would be using for installation and where all those things would be installed. And we might have to adapt our solutions from an application perspective, but the technology is available with us to take care of 4G, 5G, and any other G, future Gs which come in.
Just to add to that, my basic understanding says it is going to be harmful because 5G is much, much higher frequency they are going to use than what we are using right now as a 4G. So,
what I've read is that medical reports that the 5G signal will penetrate the cells of the human body much more. So to detect if people who have certain problems, short-term problems or long-term problems, that problem might rapidly increase. I mean, if suppose somebody were to get a problem in 5 years, with 5G, that may get escalated to 2 years or 3 years. So that could happen. That's what I've been reading in the research papers which are coming in from Europe and other places. So, yes.
So great. Thank you so much for answering all the questions. I think most of the questions are similar, so we can close the Q&A. Thank you so much, Pranavji and Manisha ji.
Thank you, Sanjeev, for moderating the Q&A.
And pleasure, sir.
Thank you to everybody who spent the last 15 minutes with us. I hope you found this session useful. A lot of you have shown interest in receiving the digital handbook and more information. Our team will connect with you very, very soon. And we will be sharing this digital handbook with all of you by next week. So thank you again for attending and for sparing your valuable time.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.